After waving bye-bye to the Atlanta Braves, Fife County Stadium now bids yoo-hoo to the Brew Crew.
And while it's true this new Major League affiliation with the advanced single-A Carolina Mudcats boasts just one World Series appearance in 48 years, what it does bring to our little corner of the world is what MLB.com counts as the number one farm system among all professional parent clubs.
So certainly we here can expect a cash crop of talent. At least six opening day roster members originally signed seven-figure bonuses along with the contract bottom line. That's millions and millions of reasons to invest in the 2017 season. And if you don't believe me, check with new dugout boss, Joe Arolt.
I got an exciting group of guys here, and I'm really fired up to start the season.
Counting all those big bucks for Milwaukee's up-and-coming best begs just one question. Will they pay off with the playoff?
So let's spin that Mudcat Wheel of Fortune. This season, at any moment, the price is right for the out of sight. Brewers' very top prospect, Coy Ray, arrived Easter Sunday with plenty of fanfare by pegging and legging a triple on his first at bat. Number six prospect, Trent Clark.
The one thing that's been said about you and on all the boards and everything is pure hitting power. How do you describe yourself as a hitter?
I'm more of a competitor. I'm up there trying to compete against the pitchers one-on-one and do what I can to help the team in any way I can. Well, you start in the offseason with your workouts, and then you go to your strength coaches and with the knowledge they give you on how to prepare your body to play every single day, because you play 140-some games in like 155 days. So you have to be ready to play every single day and get your body ready to play every day. Well, in pro ball, the ball's coming off harder, which means the reads are quicker, which means every step is more important. So you got to really focus on your mechanics and getting yourself set up while the pitch is in the zone, hitting zone. And just being prepared, knowing the outs, knowing the conditions, knowing where the wall is, knowing how many steps you have on the track, knowing who's playing next to you, just every little thing comes into account.
Before you even got into professional ball, you spent some time on the 18 and under Team USA. And in 12 games, I think you had 24 RBIs, you batted 538, and your 923 slugging percentage. Was playing with the flag on your chest, was that inspirational, or did that bring out the best in you?
Playing for something bigger than yourself is always going to bring something out of you. Playing for a country with a country on your back and representing your country is one of the biggest honors you can have in any profession that you do. So, yeah, that had a lot to do with it. And I've always said, if you're playing for something bigger than yourself, your real talents can just come out.
Let's go back to when you started in rookie league. You had one of your earliest games in rookie league, you hit for the cycle, you had five RBI, four runs scored, a stolen base, and this is all in when you just first hit in rookie league. How are you able to hit the ground running, so to speak? And I mean just pick up from you know, ground zero.
Well, when your first year when you get drafted, you're so excited. You're so excited that you got drafted, you're so excited you're starting to pursue your dream, and people can start seeing that. So I believe all your first year is just off of pure excited, pure ecstasy, where you're just excited to be there. After that, you start to get acclimated and knowing what it's about, knowing you're competing every day. And that comes with struggles, that comes with more positives, but really that first year is just about getting out there and playing, being excited to be in professional baseball, being excited to play against guys that are very talented, and playing with guys that are very talented. So it's just a big overwhelming experience.
Number five prospect, Esan Diaz.
Glad to have you here in Zeblin. Ended up last year, Milwaukee Brewers Minor League Player of the Year.
Yes, sir.
Does that label, a great honor, does it bring any extra pressure or expectation that you put on upon yourself coming into this season?
I don't think so. To be quite honest, I kind of forgot about it already. Just trying to put everything in the past that happened last year and trying to just focus on this new year that's here. Obviously, you know, new place, new home, new environment. You know, just trying to get better every day and trying to just double what I did last year. It's a privilege to have that upon myself, and I think it's just trying to keep my routine the same way. Obviously, every day in this game you learn, and with different coaches that come your way, you obviously tend to pick up a little things that help you yourself and your game. And I think taking the game day by day and trying to just improve in the little aspects of the game kind of bring you a long way. And I think, you know, just trying to go out there and play 100% and giving the fans what they want, and which is, you know, fun and an energetic person or player, I should say, that that, you know, they love to watch.
You're not a stereotypical shortstop. You're more like a prototypical. I mean, you're coming off with 59 extra base hits last year, 75 RBI. That's a lot for that position. Do you think something like that, an ability to do all that, to be such an offensive firepower, gives you an edge as you're moving up and people say, hey, listen, we need this guy in the lineup?
Yeah, I mean, obviously it was a great season last year. You know, put up some good numbers there. And this year is all about just trying to stay consistent. And the biggest thing, you know, not a good for me, a good friend of mine, a mentor of mine, Francisco Lindor, who obviously played here. You know, his big thing is being consistent and trying to, you know, stay the same, stay positive, and coming out and just playing, you know, your hardest every day. And you can't control what happens on, you know, the difficult plays. You know, you make them, yank them. I think the most important thing is trying to stay consistent with the routine play. The more and more you make the routine play, I'm sure, the better it is for you. That's kind of the key thing for us infielders.
You may not have had to mentally deal with the bad slump yet. Mm-hmm. Are you prepared for that?
You know, to be honest, I did go through a little slump at the beginning of the season last year. There's some things going on that, you know, kind of just weren't going my way, whether it was the weather or just things mentally that kind of just kept me back a little bit. But once it started getting warm out and you know, just trying to get the feel of myself as far as being in the batter's box, you know, kind of just felt good and kind of just found the feeling again. You know, and if obviously failure is going to come, it's going to come, and we just got to be ready for it. I think it's basically more upon myself as a hitter and as a player to try and fix that. You know, because once you get to the big leagues, there's no one there to help you. You're on your own, and you know, there's not going to be a teammate or a coach there that's going to, you know, give you or grab you by your hand and say, hey, we got to go to the cage and do this and that. You kind of got to take that as an initiative on your own and stay consistent with that. But that's kind of just what helps you get there and stay there as a big leaguer.
This is a town, Zevlin, that loves its managers. You've been doing this for a while. You've been at the advanced single A in the Brewers. This is your sixth season. Does that consistency and longevity at these levels help these kids that are coming through?
I think so. You know, I've been experienced, been in the game a long time. You know, I actually played in this stadium, 94, 95, 97, came up with the Atlanta Braves. So just being an experienced Carolina League guy as a player, and then I've been in the Florida State League the past 8 years. Got my family in Sarasota, Florida, so I've spent a lot of time. Wanted to stay close to my family, so this is kind of the first year away from home, kind of for the summer. But looking forward to it. Great group of guys.
You spent seven games with the Braves in 1996. How was that? I mean, we're all guys that we've never experienced that. What is it like being in the show?
It was a great experience for me. I can't call it a cup of coffee. We'll call it a smell of coffee being up there in the big leagues that year. But getting to spend time with that pitching staff we had with the Braves in the 90s was unbelievable. I mean, you got three Hall of Famers on the staff. So, I mean, I've taken a lot from the managers I've had, Bobby Cox in the past, Randy Engel, Bruce Benedict, Southern League manager, all those guys trying to blend it, their ways of managing, and kind of put it to use how I manage today. Those guys, how they went about their business. Greg Maddux is the guy, you know, he's called the professor for a reason. You ask him all kinds of questions, he's going to give you the answers. It's just a great experience for a young guy to get those types of questions answered by those guys. They were a great influence on my career.
So obviously you're not starstruck, but you will face this year with, you've got eight of the top 30 Brewer prospects on one roster. Does that make it harder or easier for you? The expectations are so much more. Is it tougher, or do you think this is going to be a piece of cake?
It's the same deal for me. I mean, I'm a baseball guy in the grind for it. You know, my job is about player development, developing these guys into championship caliber players. You know, it's great to have the talent that we have. I'd say it makes it a little more exciting. I'm just seeing guys being able to retain the stuff and move on in their career. You know, it's an exciting deal. It's a mix of everything. I mean, we're basically like a teacher, teaching all aspects of the game, the mental side, being a professional, just the little things, teaching them a routine, teaching the organizational plans as far as our fundamentals, you know, learning an approach at the plate. You know, it's all blended. You know, we're on the same page. My staff, got a great staff with me, Dave Chavarria, the pitching coach, Dave Joppy does our hitting, and Edwin Masonette is our infield defensive guy. But we're all on the same page of taking all the stuff from spring training, our experiences, and what the organization wants us to implement, and just get after it with these guys, make sure they know the plan. And we get excited sending those guys up. So, I mean, it's as good, if not better, than a win that night. We get to send a guy up to the next level.
You've been with the organization so long, you've got to be trusted. You've got these guys. When you come across guys, we're talking about infielders, we got a couple of guys who are maybe thinking about sharing the same third base spot. You've got two fantastic catcher prospects that we're talking about, Gelfi and McDowell right there. Are you the one who makes the final decision on who's starting and who gets the most reps?
I mean, it kind of all comes out in the wash. You start the year with certain guys, let them run out there, see who's retaining the information, see how the game flow is, especially behind the plate. You got to be a guy that's a leader on the field, not only be able to catch the ball, block, and throw, you know, give you a quality at-bat that night. So it all kind of comes out in the wash. Having two guys like that, I mean, it's going to be a fun year for us. Both of them good leadership guys in the long run are going to be two big prospects. I mean, I think overall our whole team is prospects. I'm one of those guys. The work, the effort you put in, every guy. I mean, it doesn't matter to me. You're a first-round pick. You're a free agent. I get after it, man. I want all these guys. Let's get the most out of their ability. So I go about my day. Let's go. Let's see what we can do and help guys out to get 1% better every day. I mean, you can go around the infield. Yeah. Lucas Erceg at third base. I mean, the kid's first full season, power bat. He hits the all fields. I mean, he's a high-energy, max effort. He gets after him. He's a real highly touted prospect, and there's good reason why. He's got the tools to go with it. At shortstop, he's also going to be playing short and second. Eason Diaz, I mean, banged out 20 bombs last year in the Midwest League. Guy can flat out hit. Was in the Arizona Fall League, one of the top guys out there, and you know, a solid kid. So the other guy playing second and short is Luis Aviles. Kid's got, you just look at him. I mean, just his stature alone is a big league prospect, and he's got a live body. Gets after it, makes the routine plays. He's a real exciting player. And moving over to first base, Jake Gatewood. You got a big four-hole hitter type with big-time power. And he's played a lot of left side of the infield, a lot of third, a lot of short. So having a guy like that at first base, we're talking an above-average defender at first base. The guy's played short and third base. So it's going to be exciting to watch that infield work. And the guy's filling in between, Wes Wilson. He's a North Carolina boy, so I'm sure he's happy to be playing in the Carolina
League.
I mean, for me, he's one of those guys, very mature for his first full season. You know, coming out of Clemson, he's a polished college guy. You know, he can play third, second, first, outfield. Gives you a quality at-bat. And the other utility guy being Wendell Rijo, who's a big prospect with the Red Sox. We got him in a trade last year, so he's going to be running out there mixing in some infield time at second and third. I mean, our outfield's going to be solid. Within a week or so, we'll be getting Corey Ray, who was our top pick in last year's draft from Louisville. Wow. So he's working on some things, making sure he's in shape for the season, so when he gets here, he's 100%. And then with Trent Clark, you know, you got another guy, young guy. He's got a great approach at the plate. He's improving his outfield stuff. I mean, the kid gets after it. He's just kind of the laid-back Texas guy, but when he's at the plate, he's ready to go. And then with Stokes and Balonis also in the outfield, and Brandon Diaz, we got a good crew of guys. I mean, for me, Stokes is that under-the-radar sleeper guy. He can flat-out get after it, can hit a fastball. But, I mean, our whole staff, bullpen, Grip is going to be at the end of the ball games. He's kind of funky, but he gets after it, attacks it. You know, he's a guy that's bulldog mentality, give me the ball anytime, gets after it. But like I said, starting rotation, we have a few tandems in there, which will be piggybacking some guys where they'll be splitting the games and then flip-flopping the next game. But like I said, great mix on the mound, and it's going to be a great year for us. It's going to change every year, depending on what your personnel is, what you're going to roll with. I mean, some years might be you got more power bats. We also, when I talked about the blend in our pitching staff, we have a great blend as well with our position players. We got some guys that can run, guys that can hit the ball out of the ballpark, and the guys that can do the little things, putting the ball in play with the hit and runs, moving guys over, and basically producing the run. So it's going to be a fun year. And like I said, just adapt to what you got. The way I look at it, I just try to give my best every day. What can I do to help get these players better? I mean, my job, the number one thing is to help improve these guys, develop in their development to move at the next level. So that's my thing. I got the passion for it. I love it. Always have their back in games. Hopefully I don't get the hook too many times during the year, but I want to be on the diamond coaching third and in the dugout. But these players know I have their back and I'm passionate about what I do. Now that the Carolina League has 10 teams, we're talking, you're spread out, you get more competition, so you're not just battling the same other seven teams all the time. So I think it's great for the Carolina League to add the two teams. It's going to be a fun year. You're playing more teams to see different stadiums, see different players and organizations. So it's going to be it's great for the Carolina League to add the two teams.
When you came through here, Five County Stadium, a long time ago, it was a whole lot different. When you walked into the stadium today, did you say, things have changed?
Oh, definitely. I mean, the front office was great. Being on the visiting side, you know, you don't get to meet too many front office people. So coming in yesterday, getting to meet Eric and Joe Kramer, you know, it was unbelievable. And then seeing the stadium, what they've done. Back in the day, we had a little two-way trailer deal for our clubhouse coming in there, you know, almost breaking through the floorboards. So it was great to see the field's in incredible shape. Groundskeeper John doing a heck of a job. We had a workout yesterday. All our players were commenting how nice the field is. It's going to be, seeing the Jumbotron out there, it's a great look for the stadium.